Okay. Hello, writers and crafters. I'm Valerie Eason.
And I'm Eric Mertz.
And this is episode 60. Yay.
I love that round seems numbers.
Like, I know. It sounds like a landmark episode. It is March 23rd, 2022, as we record this. And today we're going to talk about setting and world building and all that goes into that. The podcast is sponsored by our patrons at patreon.com/Valerie Eason, Ihsan. For as low as a dollar a month, you can get a shout out on the podcast and we can make announcements for you. At other tiers, the benefits really shoot up. There's accountability Zoom calls, scene analysis, like free coaching. There's a lot of stuff there. So go check out patreon.com/Valerie Eason. There is only 1 week left for registration for the Writer Craft Writing Retreat and Workshop that closes April 2nd, so I can secure the venue. So please go to the website, valerieeason.com/retreat, and check out the monthly payment plan. And if you've got any questions, you can always email us. So, Eric, what's been going on?
Well, what am I reading? That's a lot.
Reading and what's going on?
Well, I'm reading. I don't read much memoir. I think I read more memoir than I think I do. When I look at my year end, I realize I read more. But whenever I pick one up, I think, oh my, wow, I'm reading a memoir. This is cool. I'm checking out comedy drama, the Bob Odenkirk's new memoir. He's the Better Call Saul, the actor who plays Saul Goodman, Jimmy McGill from the Breaking Bad world. Talk about world building. Mm-hmm. So I've been in a real, like, I've been into comedians lately. I've been into like what makes comedians work. And so reading his memoir has been really, real interesting view on just what being a comedian and trying to write funny is like. How hard that is. Uh-huh. He talks a lot about, like, you know, he just would write 100 jokes a day and hope that one worked. And that is that sounds really intimidating to me. So yeah, that's what I'm reading. And, you know, I'm just getting through some writing. I'm working on a prequel book. Unexpectedly found myself writing a different story and I'm loving it. So
cool. A different story, as in the different from what you're working on, or is it still in the Strange Air mystery?
It is in the same world. So in the newest novel, Chasing Shadows, Melville hooks up with a writer Sandoval. Yeah, he becomes his sort of, paranormal mystery co-detective, you know, there. And uh-huh. I kept thinking, like, what is this guy's story? I really want to know who Sandoval is, partly because I've known who Melville is forever. Mm-hmm. And I was fun to dive into somebody else. So I thought, oh, I'll write a short story about Sandoval's past, you know, what got him into the paranormal. And now I'm like 75,000 words into it.
Oh my God.
it just keeps coming.
That is a fantastic short story.
Yeah, it's a
that's an epic short story.
It's the longest short story ever. So yeah, it evolved. Like, then it was going to be a series of short stories, interconnected short stories, and then about the last, when I mapped out the last, how the whole story ends, I just had to say, all right, this is a novel. This is, mm-hmm. I just wrote a book without even knowing it, really.
That's amazing. I wish that would happen more often, you know, like, oh, surprise, I just wrote a book. Whoa. I've only done that one other time, but it wasn't that long. It was a nonfiction thing that I was working on. And I was just typing up some notes for a class that I was going to teach. And then I was like, oh, wait a minute. This is a book.
This is a book.
Surprise.
I feel like when all my books get together later in life, this one's going to say, well, you know, it's like a big family, that this one's going to say, I was an accident. And then, everyone will pat it on the head and say, oh, you're so cute. But no, it's been fun. He's a new character. He's a new person. It's a new world. It's a variation on the old world. Mm-hmm. And it's been a lot of fun. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Can't wait to read it all the way through, because I never thought of it as being something to read all the way through. So what's going on with you?
Well, I finished reading Body Work by Melissa Phoebos and realized that in my own memoir, I have missing scenes. And some of those missing scenes are ones that I don't even know are missing. And some of them are ones I've deliberately left out because I was too like embarrassed or ashamed, you know, to go there. Mm-hmm. And this book, Body Work, made me realize that what I was being too safe in the memoir, and I'm telling a story of my story, and I need to be more there in the pages. And that's a little uncomfortable. because
wait, when you say uncomfortable, do you mean uncomfortable that you wrote it believing that it was all there and now you're recognizing it, or the recognition that how far you have to go?
Well, both actually, but okay. I first meant like, ooh, it's going to be uncomfortable to dive to that depth.
Right.
And I like the narrative that I've told myself about my story. Mm-hmm. So I have to go to darker, more, well, ugly places. And, and that doesn't sound comfortable in the sense that I know that people that know me are going to read this and then know this about me, you know, but that's the whole point of writing a memoir.
Right.
So yeah, there's some extra work that needs to be done, and yes, it will take longer. And that's always frustrating for me because I have that type A drive that, you know, wants to get stuff done and cross things off my list. And now this has become a bigger list, but I think it will tie in nicely to our topic today.
Oh, nice segue. Good job.
Because setting and world building, because I don't write fantasy, I thought, well, that just doesn't apply to me. You know, there is no, I don't need to build a world. My characters are just in the one we live in. Everybody knows about that, but that's totally not true.
Right.
World building still encompasses the world that the character lives in, whether it's Chicago or Albany, Oregon, or, you know, Jackson City, whatever, you know.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
That is a, you know, I haven't been to like Jackson Hole, Wyoming. I don't know what the world is like over there. So if your novel takes place there, then, you know, bring it. I want to see what the sunsets look like. I want to know how people interact with others on the street as you're walking by. Do you look at people when you walk by them on the street? Do you say hello? You know, I went to, I lived in Kalispell, Montana for a few years in my 20s, and it's a small rural town. And the entire, at the time that I lived there anyway, the entire population of the state of Montana did not equal the population of like Portland, Oregon.
Right.
Everybody's really spread out there. So if you see anybody, you're talking to them, you're waving to them, whatever.
Right.
Even when you're driving, you know, raise your hand off the steering wheel and just, you know, acknowledge or nod to the other person, and the other driver does the same. And, you know, and when I came here and started doing that, the people in the car I'd be driving with would say, oh, did you know that person? No, you just wave. And they thought that was really weird. So world building encompasses things like that too.
Yeah. There was a screenwriting class at one of the Willamette Writers conferences. I don't remember which one, but when they talked about world building, they put it in a way that I could really grasp. And that was, New York is not just New York. If you watch a Marty Scorsese movie like Goodfellas and a Woody Allen movie like Manhattan, that's the same city. But it's not the same world. Mm-hmm. And so that really opens, because I love both of those directors and both of those movies, but it really outlined how important it is to, even if the assumption of a place it can be really a challenge for a writer. If you assume that the reader knows your New York, because they've seen New York and other things, that can be a really, that can lead you down the wrong path, right? Because you're not carving out your own version of it. If everybody thought of Montana as I don't know, what's the biggest city in Montana, Missoula or something, Billings?
I don't even know anymore.
Right. But even in a place like Montana, like we're small town Montana versus the city Montana, there's going to be slight differences. There's mm-hmm. going to be, so you have to carve that. You can't take for granted that your reader knows those things.
Right. And if you're worried about like being stereotypical, then you can always go down a layer or five and get into, I mean, it becomes, it's not stereotypical if you are talking about a person and their response to their surroundings, because right. that is individual. So that can't be stereotypical if you are writing it with authenticity.
So talk about what you just said, because I think I grasp it, but I think it, to me, to go down a layer or two or five. Mm-hmm. So when you're talking about getting past the stereotype is the surface level that everybody recognizes, right?
That instant categorization of, this is cowboy what New York looks down. Like. This is what Montana looks like. Yeah.
Right. So when you talk about layers going down, how do you think about that?
I think it is opening the door so that the reader can see parts of the world that they wouldn't normally see if they were just watching it on TV, or if they were just driving through to the next town. You know, it's so they can see past that surface level. And you can do that by, I mean, in a very like surface level, you could do that by naming streets, you know, turning down Broadway instead of he drove down the road, you know, so that people can see it and showing the reader like what stores are on the street, or you know, weather is always a setting that I never remember to put in my stories. Or when I do remember, it's like this throw off of, it was raining or it was gray outside. And then if I only do that like once every three chapters, then it just looks like it's raining and gray the entire book.
Yeah.
So when I go in and add setting, I have to go in after I've written the book and add it in deliberately to all the scenes or, you know, thereabouts. So that's like one layer of depth for world building. But then I would think, you know, if you can get down into the cultural world that the character lives in and reacts to, and
that's
and
the rich stuff.
Yeah. And you have, that takes more research. So if you haven't actually lived it yourself, then, you know, you do run the risk of stereotyping even the culture. So being mindful of, you know, is this an accurate representation of the way a person would react in this world? What are the problems in this world? What makes it broken? What makes it not work? Why is there conflict between the character and the world he lives in? And I think to me, those are the layers that you can get to when you're world building.
Right.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does. It does. I think.
You don't sound satisfied.
Because it's a complicated process, right? You're talking about, you're talking about that mythical street, right? Or that fictional mm-hmm. street. And so, you know, we're talking a Montana scene. You have a guy in a flannel shirt, belt buckle, boots. He's a stereotype cowboy. Drives a truck, walks down that street. I mean, I've got one of these guys mm-hmm. in my story, right? So mm-hmm. I hear what you're saying. Like you walk down the street, you name the street, you name the businesses, you start to add the layers of personal
memory.
That's setting
and also world building. So setting, I think, is part of world building, but world building encompasses so much more.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that's where I conceive of world building. It's where the story and the setting and the character all come together. It's in that mm-hmm. Venn diagram. They all mm-hmm. overlap in that place. It's the thing you can't extract. It's that the character is in a town. Maybe there's a memory there that invokes a wound that they have to, and that the setting, they can't, until they leave, that walking around that corner where they get their heart broken is always going to bring up that memory, that kind of thing, right? Mm-hmm. So when they're that inextractable overlap in the Venn diagram is where you start doing world building. But there is that, I think that even in our levels of experience, I mean, we're talking about it in a thoughtful, like, you know, it's hard to talk about it with authority, no matter what your experience is, because it's unique to every story you write. And I always run up against, how am I doing too much of it sometimes? Every time a character gets out of a car in a parking lot, do we have to know the story of the restaurant they're walking into? Do we have to have a memory of what used to be across the street? I struggle sometimes with, and I hear it from my writers group a lot, like, we don't need that little extra jaunt down memory lane. Keep on that line.
Think it depends on, it's just like any other scene, right? If it doesn't carry the story forward or tell us about the character, then maybe it's not necessary. And I love to read books where the setting is a character, becomes a character.
Yeah, me too.
And that world that is created by the author is another character. And it can be in conflict with other characters.
Right.
And it comes with its own past and its own culture. And I really love that when I find that in novels. So I aspire to write that, but strangely, I have that. I mean, that rough draft doesn't have any of that in there. So it doesn't come naturally for me at all. I have to go in. And so I work through layers myself, if you want to get into the nitty gritty. I do want to name that street, and I do want to know, like, what season, just timeline wise, like, what season is this? How long does this book last? The story, is this over the course of a week? Is it over the course of a year? Is it a season? What season is that? Are there holidays, you know? And what makes it a little more realistic is, you know, I don't think about, like, if it takes place in December, and it's cold and rainy and gross and everyone's plugged into their happy light so that they can stay alive. But, you know, other things that happen in December that maybe I am not, like, we're not a big Christmas celebrator in our family. When I divorced with my husband, he took Christmas and I took solstice. And the kids are gone now. So, you know, I light a candle on solstice, but it's not like I go buy presents for a whole bunch of people you know, and my husband is Turkish and, you know, Christmas wasn't really a holiday that you celebrated in Turkey, but New Year's Eve totally is. So that's where my attention goes. But so I would forget to write, like, other holiday stuff into a December scene. You know, if there's a character running downtown to go grab something because blah, 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 whatever, it's part of the story. But because it's December, you know, maybe they have a lot of traffic. Maybe there's, you know, stupid carols playing in, you know, the Muzak grocery store or whatever. I don't know, but that's another layer of setting that would add realism also. I have a
question before I think that as the, you having more of an editorial brain, you know, when you read a story and you're aware of that, of the author is building their world, do you feel as though there is a natural winnowing down of world building as the story plot and character advance towards their confrontation, their final end?
Winnowing down. What do you mean by that?
Well, like in the beginning, when you're building those first few chapters, right, you're setting up, this is the street, this is the corner where this happened, this is why he's not just a cowboy with boots and a flannel, he's a three-dimensional person. That's your world building, right? But as that confrontation, as that character's moving towards that confrontation, the you know, the big story climax, do you find that, like, well-orchestrated stories start to peel away some of that layer? You don't, when they're running down the street to have that confrontation, you're not naming the business that's on the corner because they're focused on that thing. Do you feel like that's something that good books do, or do you think that you're consistently building that world up to the conflict, final conflict?
I think there's a consistent build, but mindful of the pacing. Like you said, you're not going to describe right. this setting if, you know, they're running from a killer.
Right.
But
stop, pause. Oh, I know that store. I've been there before. I had my first her birthday party there. Right. Moving on. Right.
No, but there is a point in trauma, like when it's happening, where you do get really micro. Mm-hmm. So if you are like in a car accident and you're waiting for someone to, you know, get you out of the car, you're right. going to see like what's right in front of your face, and like right. everything else is going to stop. So that's a place for setting that would be really effective, I think, because there is that like everything stops and you're focused on this one thing. You know, like when my husband died, the house was full of people. I was sitting in a chair in the kitchen right by the phone, and somebody asked if I wanted a bagel, like totally random. Didn't carry right. the story forward. Nothing. Like, I mean, it did show like people milling around and trying to be useful, which is totally authentic to right. sudden death and grief and the family not knowing what to do. But it was funny to me later that right, was the right. thing that stuck in my head. So, right. so yeah, you're going to micro down in moments of like, not when they're being chased by the killer, but maybe they're hiding now.
Right.
And there's behind a tree, you know, and the bark is like pushed up against their face and it feels like, you know, blah, blah, blah. So yes, I think that the world building is going to happen all throughout strategically. And it's right. better that way than to info dump world building at the beginning of your book, which is really boring to read.
Right. Right. Well, I like what you said, and I'm sorry I cut you off, because I know you were going somewhere, but I think that mindful of pacing is what I was thinking of, is that mm-hmm. idea that it's not always the same. You can't treat every street corner the same way. And look, I mean, what you're describing is, I don't know, The Girl Who Loved Tom Gordon, the Stephen King book, which is not a great Stephen King book, but it does take that idea that like the world, building a world is different in your everyday, and then when you're in a trauma state, you know, mm-hmm. when you're in that state of hiding, which is with that girl, the girl's in like she's been lost, and she's remembering and thinking of things that just wouldn't make sense, but it's part of the world, is like she's mm-hmm. in a traumatic state.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's important to know, because pacing is something we've talked about this before too. We have to do everything we're talking about simultaneously in a good book, right? You have to build the character, build the story, build the, you know, mindful of pacing. So it's an orchestration.
Mm-hmm. I think that the places that I'm personally interested in right now in developing in my own craft, because I feel lacking in it. And because I'm at that stage of writing this manuscript where, okay, now I'm going to start putting this in, is, you know, I always called it like the settings pass, but it's also a sensory pass too.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, we've got like the five senses, and we are a predominantly like visual, I wanted to say culture, but that doesn't sound like the right word to use, but most
animal.
Of what, yeah,
we're a visual animal, right?
There you go.
As opposed to a dog.
Yeah. So it's easy for us to write down what the character sees or what a reader would see as if they were watching a movie. So it's right. quite easy to add sight as a sense to our books. But I think a lot of us, you know, forget about like smell or
right.
I read a book a couple months ago about a profoundly deaf person. And so there was no sound in the entire book on purpose mm-hmm. because right. she couldn't hear anything. So that was really interesting. It was kind of a removal of us of setting, but deliberate, and it created I don't know, the setting became more special in a way. Right, and I was more right. focused as a reader on what she could see because she couldn't hear anything. So other than going through and adding different senses. You know, what is this scene smell like, whatever. And you can't, I think a person could probably overkill that.
Yes.
You don't want to add like what every scene smells like. I think that would be a little bit like jarring, I think, or not jarring, but just noticeable to the reader. And you really want your reader to not notice that they're reading a book.
Right. Right. That's the goal.
That's the goal. So, and then we talked a little bit about the weather and the season, like how much time has passed. So that's another thing to think about, I guess, when you're adding scenes or adding senses to the scenes and setting. But also the ones that I don't think about at all, and I think would be actually very good for writing memoir, for instance, but also maybe psychological thrillers or something where there's a lot of not just felt senses, but also that like extra sensory perception. Or, mm-hmm. you know, if you're writing a paranormal mystery, you know, there's right. got to be a little bit of the, one of the characters at least has to be like kind of in tune to that. Like, oh, right. what does yeah. this room feel like? Or, you know, is somebody psychic? I mean, that's kind of a right. stereotypical thing, but maybe, you know, they rely on their intuition a lot or just, their perceptions can be right. added in. And that's part of setting too. That's part of
right.
world building and characterization.
And character, right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely. I always feel like with paranormal, you have to like the main conflict, I think, in paranormal stories is always belief versus disbelief, right? I mean, the X-Files made an entire franchise off of that, the tension there. And I think somebody's got to believe, and that belief has to come from that extrasensory something. They have to, in the five senses, they have to find that sixth sense that tells them there's something more here.
Yeah. So. And that creates a really fun and interesting conflict between characters too. Like in the show Lost, you know, there was the surgeon who was very right. like scientific. And then there was John, I forget his name, but he was John Locke. Yeah. He was all about faith. You know, he was right. the one that could walk suddenly. He was in a wheelchair. Right. Before he crashed and now he can walk. So
you're going to make me watch that show again. And I don't have that time. I love that show. I love it.
I loved the first maybe three seasons. And then I was like kind of watching it because I had to, you know, like, okay, what's the end going to be? And at the end, I was just like, oh yeah.
I thought the last episode was great. Now that's a controversial topic for another day.
Totally.
Because some people hate that. You said something about when you talked about the senses, and I was reading those Jeffrey Deaver short stories, and one of those short stories in the first paragraph describes the smell of, it's like a hostage situation, it takes place in a restaurant, and an old restaurant, and it in a seacoast resort town kind of thing, and there was one sentence that described the smell, and it was like the mix of, you know, briny salt water and old fryer grease or something. It was perfect. Mm-hmm. And for 30 pages of a short story, that sense impression stayed. So when you talked about overkill, I thought of that. Like if you're using, especially smell, because if you hit that right note with smell, people will just, they'll smell it. It's usually something unpleasant or overwhelmingly pleasant, like potpourri. Like when that word comes out, I can smell that grandma living room. So I think, again, there's one, you don't have to do that in every scene. And if you don't want that reader going, oh, wow, they're doing their check down. Here's what it looked like, smelled like, tasted like, tasted like can be really awkward if someone's always eating something, but balance, got to have that balance. And you have to trust that like when you've got to, if you're going to hit somebody with a strong sensory something, that it carries through. You don't want the reader knowing they're in a book. You want them to feel like they're in the experience.
So Eric, as a fantasy writer and a paranormal writer, your world building is different than my world building.
Very different.
So what is different about world building for a fantastical story or audience?
I'm glad you put it that way, because I think that to sit here and go through science fiction and fantasy and paranormal and horror and all those things, it would, I think there's a lot of overlap between those things.
Yeah.
So I think for one, I think there has to be something that is you have to build the normal world for one thing, right? Okay. And I think even you see that in fantasy books. In fantasy and sci-fi are a little different because you're building a imaginary real world. So I think
another planet or another land, right? Or
right. I think the key to doing that well is, again, you're not spending a lot of time info dumping. You're not spending a lot of time over describing something. You are describing the room on the spaceship as though these things are normal. It's just that this is the normal set of new things that your characters are interacting with, the same way you would describe the bar in that town in Montana that might be familiar to your reader, but you're describing how the people interact with that. I think the first thing is there has to be a baseline, and you have to establish what that baseline is and treat it like the baseline. Because again, that's where your reader is going to know that you're pointing at things and trying to highlight them too much. So just
say more about baseline.
Well, again, if the spaceship is whatever that unique element you've created, whatever you're calling the technology, whatever is on the spaceship, right? If it's a prison ship or if it's a science ship, you're creating a baseline understanding of the setting, right? That there's a laboratory here, there's a prison cell there, there's red lights that run the hall of corridors, whatever they are. And it has to
be artfully told as well. You can't just info dump that, there's red lights that line the blah, blah, blah. And it would be more, I would assume, the character walking through and interacting with the setting as he's going about his action.
I try to think of it as just, it's the same thing. And the cowboy example is perfect. It's the same thing as that cowboy walking down the street, interacting with, I need to pick up something at the store. There's my car. There's those things that we do when we're interacting with our street. Your character's doing the same thing in those fantastical settings. And I think you can tell when a writer trusts that they're building that spaceship, that fantasy world, because it feels just like that person walking down the street. Now, that being said, all of those genres, I think, readers demand that there's an elevation at a certain point in those settings, right? The spaceship is going to do something that nobody's ever seen, and that's going to be, it's going to transform and go into hyperspace, or something's going, you're going to find out something new about it. There's going to be a new thing to interact with. Same thing with fantasy, right? You're in this village, everybody's eating a meal, sitting around, listening to the band. Something's going to come in and interrupt that setting. Mystery, something's going to shatter the stasis of that street. In all those places, I think the genres demand that that's done a certain way, right? It's got to be, one's got to be scientific, another one's got to be, very fantastical, probably involving magic or a creature no one's seen. Mystery, it's got to involve some sort of crime or intrigue or a clue revelation. So I think that it's, again, you're setting that baseline setting for the reader to trust in. And as you're moving forward, you can start to do things with that. And you can tell a fantasy story that needs some development or science fiction that needs development when the author is trying to catch up with that. Oh, let me remind you of how this works because it's about to change. Building all of that up, that normal interaction, I think is so key, because you want the focus in those heightened moments to be on what is changing, what is different, what is threatening the character and their world.
So it's been said before in our industry that the Harry Potter books were a great way to introduce a new world without the info dumping, because it started with
fantastic.
An ordinary dude.
Right.
And so he got to experience everything that the character or that the reader, I said that backwards, the reader gets to experience everything that Harry Potter experienced. And so that awe and wonder that he saw at all these new wild, fantastical things is the same as the reader. So if you are not bringing an ordinary person into an extraordinary world, and you're starting with an extraordinary character in an extraordinary world,
right?
I guess, how do you avoid that info dumping? I think you alluded to it a little bit, just like take them through their ordinary world. And I guess what I'm trying to ask is, I like to read books that take me to a place I've not been before, whether right. it's like historical Holland or like whatever. Right. So I want to go to a place I haven't been before, and I want to walk the streets with the character. So right. how do we write that without info dumping, I guess. Right. I guess maybe that's the word I'm afraid of.
Well, Harry Potter is a perfect example, because I'm reading them for the first time with my 7-year-old kid, and I'm on book number, I'm on the Goblet of Fire. Mm-hmm. And Goblet of Fire is actually a really great way to have this conversation. Because the first Harry Potter is, right, new guy in town, so everything is new to him, and the author gets to reveal those things. And that's your first book. Mm-hmm. Right? Because by the second book, he or she is not the new person in town anymore. They have that little bit of experience. And what I think J.K. Rowling did really well is she always shook up that beginning of the book a little bit. Yes, we always started in Privet Drive in some way, but the circumstances in Privet Drive were a little different. And Harry's access to Hogwarts changed a little bit every time. And there was always a layer in that first act that allowed the writer, now I'm just thinking about it from her craft perspective, there was always an element in that first act that allowed her to reintroduce things, right? In Goblet of Fire, there's the Quidditch Cup at the beginning of the book, which as I'm reading it to my kid, he's like, this is terrible, they're not at Hogwarts. But I kept thinking, like, there's a device, she's doing something here. Mm-hmm. And because she's a good writer, I didn't know what it was. Now that I'm reaching the end, I recognize what she was doing. She was mm-hmm. She was world building for this book. Mm-hmm. So I think that if you are suggesting sort of series mentality or like longer, you know,
not necessarily.
I feel like if you're talking about genres, I think that it walks that line. Like, yeah. I think it's always introducing things in book sense, like just varying your introduction. Cause if it's always new, like that old Western where like it's a new, you know, the new sheriff in town storyline is just, it doesn't work episode after episode. You have to vary like what the challenges are. And it'll let that varied challenge that you introduce your character to in the beginning gives you an opportunity. I mean, I'm doing that in Chasing Shadows, where I've introduced Melville, he's out there. Now I have to shift up a little bit of how he's getting into this mystery. And in the next one, I'm going to have to shift how he's getting into that mystery, so that it never feels like I'm introducing those uncanny paranormal mystery elements the same way. Because then the reader is going to be like, you know, flipping digital pages or print pages, because the world's been built for them. I think that, you know, is a key. Like you have to treat, even though you might be sharing a world, you have to change up what that world looks like a little bit, introduce new elements of it, or it's just going to be the same old Hogwarts every time. Mm-hmm. And it's really not. The interaction on Goblet of Fire with Hogwarts is different than every other book that I've read so far, right? It feels different. Harry isn't walking a different, we're not talking as much about classrooms. He's always in the shadows and the fringes, and it's different than the first book, whole different world. And you're relying on your reader knowing that to get you there.
So many things that I wanted to say to that, and I have forgotten about three of them.
I think I talked for like 3 minutes there about 50 topics, but
so let's see, this will be in no particular order.
Sure.
I did want to circle back to when you are, so I write standalones, I don't write in series,
right?
So I can't rely on, I mean, I still have to trickle in the world building.
Right.
So I guess my concern as a standalone novelist is to introduce the world So Harry Potter, then, what if this were a book, a standalone book written by the perspective of Hagrid? Like, he's in his world. It never really changes. You know, like, how do we introduce a world that is normal to this one guy in one book without info dumping? I know that that's hard to do.
It's really hard to do. And it's funny because as we started this podcast talking about, right, like my short story that turned into a novel, I actually wrote that short story after listening to a podcast where there was a short story guru on that podcast. And he was talking about every short story, and actually every story he came on to say, has a shatter. There's a shattering moment in that story. It either happens before the story begins and the character's reacting to that shattering moment. It happens at the beginning. It happens toward the end. There's a moment where the world shatters and the story is about, in some way, a reaction to the normal world breaking. But I think that same challenge exists in short, that he described in short stories, where the real world has to shatter and force the character to adapt. I think that's to avoid info dumping. I think you're also, like, if your shattering moment, if that big act one moment is going to be where the world changes for that hero, you know, that hero's journey, depict that normal world and then break it up a little bit, right? That person, if it's about a breakup, the first act of that story is about, here's the world of their relationship. They break up. Now the world's different because he or she is looking at it from a jaded, hurt lover's perspective. And I think you have all those tools of point of view and characterization that's where that they overlap. That interaction changes the world. Now the world is different.
So you're saying that that Harry Potter first book, where he's going in and totally seeing everything new for the first time, which is easier world building, is actually true for all stories. Once they hit that shattering mark and their world changes, everything's new. And now, that's interesting.
Right, because J.K. Rowling sets up this world where this kid is, you know, this poor kid. I have a closet that I always, every time I open it, I think, like,
Harry used to live here.
Right. But right. So he's in this normal world. And then when she breaks that and says, well, welcome to Hogwarts, because the reader is still reeling at that moment of change, because every reader was like, oh my God, like, this isn't Privet Drive. This is a whole different thing.
You're a wizard, Harry.
You build yourself as a writer. I think you build yourself the opportunity to start layering in more things, right? Now you're contradicting the world you just built. This is a drab gray place with abusive aunt and uncle and some, what's his name, Dudley, you know, being the most boring person in the world. Now you're with Hermione. And I think those moments, I think you said, be mindful of pacing. And I think, like, be mindful of pacing and also be mindful of pivotal points in the story. When the story changes, you're rebuilding that world again.
Exactly. Also, per scene, you were, this was another thing I wanted to circle back on. You had said at one point that your critique group often says, oh, we don't need this. We don't need this. This is too much scene setting. Right. So the rule of thumb that I've used for a while is introductions. So someone once told me, when you introduce a character for the first time, this is the first time they've come on the screen, like, you have to spend a little bit of time introduce, if they're a main character,
right?
Or they will be, then spend some time, you know, describing this person in an artful way, of course,
right?
Not necessarily what they look like, but just spend some time kind of introducing them. And I think the same is true for setting. So when you enter a new place for the first time, that's when you can set the stage and be, you know, a little bit more micro on what's in the room and what's on the street. And then, like you said, with the smell, like, you don't have to say it again. Like, they'll just know. Yeah. When Harry went and saw that Diagon Alley entry, you know, behind the bar the very first time, they spent some time on that, you know, like the squares and I can't see it. And, you know, there was some struggle there, which always reminds me of the labyrinth, the same thing when she's in the labyrinth and the worm's like, it's right there. Just walk through the door and then you see it. So that whole scene setting is pretty micro. You know, you really get into like what color the stones are and, you know,
right.
the sounds behind them in the bar and, you know, the right. feeling of what's going to happen and all that. But they never do that again.
Right. Then the next time they go into Diagon Alley, it's just,
normal.
We know that. Yeah.
Hit the button. Now we're in.
That's a big, yeah. I think that's a huge point when it comes to fantasy, sci-fi, those kind of things is you're on that ship, that ship we're making up now, right? And mm-hmm. it's a science ship and you've described this place. Then act one breaks when the alarms go off, something is going wrong. That's your opportunity to describe that whole setting over again, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, now it's with the alarms going, it's with the lights focusing, we're focusing on something new. That's a great, I never thought of it that way, but this idea of micro, you can get micro when those moments change mm-hmm. and take advantage of that. If the smell didn't change, don't go and change that smell, but focus on what matters
right.
in that moment. I really thought it was interesting when he gets into Diagon Alley. I don't think the first book was that well written. Like the prose wasn't well written. Mm-hmm. I thought the storytelling was beautiful. But I remember very clearly when he gets onto Diagon Alley, she gave like a sentence description of the ordinary faces in there. And that was to me, like when I read that, like my writer heart went, that's beautiful. Because like, I need to know mm-hmm. that they're just, that to him, they just look like ordinary people. That built the world to me in a, mm-hmm. in a more profound way than she could have done in a lot of things. That wizards, and they look like everybody else, right? They walk among us. And that was just such great writing. And it was just so simple.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, really. I think we kind of ran the gamut there. That was awesome.
That was a lot of fun. I love
it. Yeah. Is there anything more? There's so much more we could talk
about.
There's
so much more, right? We should do a part two on this and keep going. Is there anything else? I don't know. I think if we're going to have a leave behind, right? I think the leave behind is, this is especially where like rewriting becomes a part of your practice. And that mm-hmm. is, building the world and building the setting is, it's challenging, it's inexact. And I think that probably especially if you're writing something like in any of the genres, not like just be trusting that you've got to build it and you might have to rebuild it is a part of that. You're going to have to go back and look at it. You're going to have to, but getting it out in that first draft is really important, because a lot of that world building is like, especially in fantasy and sci-fi, that's your bread and butter. That's your concept,
that's the
right?
premise. That, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's that. So you don't want to limit the building of that premise by trying to curb your world building. So I think I would rather come to the end of a first draft with like an overbuilt world that I wanted to refocus than a world that still needed building, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, I think that's just up to the writer. Like I would say maybe the opposite, because that's my, I mean, mm-hmm. I wish that I did write a little bit more world building in the
You're
first
a building
draft.
Up. You're a building up.
But I'm a building, I'm an adder. Too. Yeah, I'm not okay. a taker adder, because I think that would hurt more, I think. You know, like I just wrote 20,000 words about how, you know, this world operates and, you know, who's in charge and the government and like all the backstory stuff and why the world is the way it is, like that stuff I think really doesn't necessarily belong in the book in that way. Like you have right. to bring it up somehow, but doing it through the interaction of character or setting.
This is a future topic, because I'm definitely a bring it, I'm a put it all in and winnow it out and move mm-hmm. some of that stuff to the next draft. You're a build it up from that first draft to the draft you want person. It's like the plot and pants debate. Like what's the best way to get through that first draft?
The one that gets all the words down.
The one that is that. You hit it.
That's the podcast episode right there.
Yeah, yeah, that's it.
Part two's done already.
Part two's done. Just finish. Get the words down. I think it's also like enjoy it. I mean, yeah. if you're not enjoying the world you build, then you might be writing the wrong story. Because,
well, I also like to think to close. I guess I like to think of when I walk into a room a hotel room, a room in my house, a room in my friend's house, whatever, you know, you get that vibe, you get the feeling of the room. Does it envelop you? What is it that you feel when you walk in the room? Does it feel not yours? Does it feel like stuff's just sort of hanging on the walls, or does it feel really inviting? And I kind of look at setting that way too. So I don't want the words to just hang on the page. Like, I want the reader to enter this room and be enveloped. And so I want to be able to write setting in that way.
Right.
And that's genre specific, like you said, and, right. and voice and all that. Hmm. Well, so much more we could talk about, but I think that's a good spot to stop.
Yeah.
It was really fun. I like this topic.
Yeah, I love it too. We could talk for another hour, I'm sure.
All right.
Part two. Well,
have a great week. And
absolutely. You too.
Yeah. And keep writing, everybody, and revising.
Talk to you soon.
Bye-bye.